Hi, y'all. I'm Charlie Daniels.
Hi, I'm Charlie Daniels Jr., and this is the Charlie Daniels Podcast. From long-haired country boy to simple man, the best there's ever been. It is a very exciting time to be a CDB fan. I'll talk a little bit more about that shortly, but we've got more with Henry Paul this episode, more music, and Dad talking about the Volunteer Jam concerts that I'm going to talk about part of here in just a second. Okay, as I told you a few episodes ago, Volunteer Jam 1, 1974, The Legend Begins. It's kind of a mouthful. It was released on August 26th, so it is available wherever you stream music, wherever you download music, wherever you buy CDs, including the CDB website store. But anyway, it's out. It's available. Please check it out. It is everything that I had hoped that it would be. I've been wearing it out since it was released, and it sounds great, especially for something that's almost 48 years old. In October, it'll be 48 years. So that's very cool. And aside from classic CDB tracks, from Honey in the Rock, Way Down Yonder, Fire on the Mountain, there are some very cool covers thrown into the mix. The Hank Williams song, Jambalaya on the Bayou, Bob Wills' Stay All Night, Stay a Little Longer, and my favorite on this entire album is an old blues number by Tampa Red. Hudson Whitaker was his real name, but it's called Don't You Lie to Me, and it's been recorded by a slew of artists, Fats Domino, Albert King, Chuck Berry, B.B. King, Stevie Ray Vaughan, just to name a few. It's a very fun, up-tempo, rock and blues song. I highly recommend checking it out. Actually, check out the entire Volunteer Jam 1, 1974, The Legend Begins album. And one little more bit of inside information regarding this package. The CDB and Friends also performed Ray Price's classic, Crazy Arms, but sadly, the original reel-to-reel tape that was transferred to DAT, digital audio tape, ran out right before the song was finished. So it kind of goes crazy, whoop. And anyway, so they didn't include that on it. And there was also two very cool jams that they did on the original tape. But I think from a publishing standpoint, it would be a nightmare because it was no actual song. When you jam, you jam, you have somebody that's kind of leading the jam and kind of pointing to everybody to solo, and you're just kind of making stuff up on, you know, the spot. And I guess trying to figure out who would be credited as songwriters, especially since so many of the people that were involved are no longer with us, it would have been really, really difficult to. But maybe there's a way to release them at some point with, I don't know, we'll do some investigating on that. But anyway, be sure to check out the album wherever you stream or download music, and CDs are available at Amazon or at store.charliedaniels.com. And there will be vinyl, as there should be, but it won't be until February of next year, so it'll be a little while, but you can still stream it until it's released. Ain't it good to be alive and be in Tennessee? Okay, once again, I've been digging through interviews and stuff, and I found Dad talking about the Volunteer Jam shows over the years. So it's part of a little jam highlight reel that we did a few years ago, and some comments from Dad about the jam shows. So anyway, here it is. Check it out.
Do you know me? Of course you do, though maybe you haven't seen me in a little while. I'm the backbeat coming through your car radio, the thumping bass that drags you along with the rhythm. I'm that part of music that makes you want to dance. I'm a pure gospel song issuing forth from a Sunday morning church house. I'm the blues at midnight oozing out of a backstreet honky-tonk. I'm the happy crystal ring of a high mountain fiddle, the plaintive wail of lost love in the wee morning hours. I draw my nourishment from the teeming streets of New York City, the lonely grain-covered plains of Minnesota, from cabaret and camp meeting, bayou and beer joint, good times and ghettos. I was born in the houses of New Orleans and traveled up the river on the northbound paddle wheelers. I was nurtured in the Mississippi Delta when the seeds of the blues sprang forth from the rich black soil. I was there when Elvis learned to sing and when B.B. got his first guitar. I'm black and white and smooth and rough and hard and soft. I'm the roots of American music, and I'm always there, just below the surface. And when the chaff of trend and fad is swept aside, I'm exposed again, strong, pulsating, and very much alive. The winds of change may blow the tree away, but the roots remain, then, now, and until the end. Volunteer Jam was almost an afterthought. It started out in 1974 with a live recording session we wanted to do for Fire on the Mountain. We wanted to record two songs live. The only place we could draw a crowd at the time was in our hometown, Nashville. So we got the 2,400 seat hall, and somebody came up with the name Volunteer Jam, and it sold out, and it took on a life of its own, basically. It was one of those kind of shows that was not, you just had this feeling, this is a happening. This is the beginning of something, rather than walking off stage and saying, we did the show, we did the session, we're out of here. So we did it again. We went from a 2,400 seat hall to a 13,000 seat hall, and we sold it out. And that was what that was all about, that Tennessee and other parts of the country were starting to catch on that time too, had come out, 13,000 people had come into a hall in Murfreesboro, Tennessee to see what this thing was, you know, to see what the Volunteer Jam was, the thing that only 2,400 people had attended the year before. Mm-hmm. But word of mouth was like wildfire. You could not get a ticket to Volunteer Jam. I mean, it was the hottest ticket in town for years.
How about it, Matter?
How about one?
How about five or six of them?
Yeah.
This is Volunteer Jam 75, and I hope we have a Volunteer Jam 85. I got to say it. This is one of the biggest honors of my life, standing on this stage in front of you people tonight. We love you.
And now a word from our sponsor, the Charlie Daniels Journey Home Project.
Only two things protect America: the grace of Almighty God and the United States military. Words of wisdom from our founder, the late Charlie Daniels. Hi, my name is David Corlew, co-founder of the Charlie Daniels Journey Home Project. From world wars, the Korean conflict, to Vietnam, the Gulf War, and as we experience the drawdown of the 20-year war against terrorism, America has continued to send the best we have into combat, defending the beliefs and the borders of our great nation. When the fighting stops, our men and women who served begin a new mission, their own journey home. The Charlie Daniels Journey Home Project offers assistance and support in the return, the rehabilitation, and the reintegration back to civilian life. We focus on education, housing, various rehabilitation programs, as well as the tragic epidemic of suicide within our own veterans community, 22 a day. Join our mission in serving those who have served us. Donate now by contacting us at the Charlie Daniels Journey Home Project.org. The Charlie Daniels Journey Home Project.org. Thank you, and God bless America.
Music time. This is a little different. This is a very sweet song. It's one of the rare ballads that the CDB has been known for over the years. This one, we have been using it as part of a music bed when we were promoting the Charlie Daniels Life Fiddle. But here is How Much I Love You from the Road Dogs album. Mm-hmm.
just your style, the way you close your eyes and smile. When I hold you close and kiss you, the way you touch my hand, you always seem to understand. And when you're gone, how much I miss you. Just being with you makes me high. That loving look that's in your eyes makes me stop and realize how very much I love you. Special little things you do, every morning waking up with you, makes me want to live forever. We'll take whatever comes our way, if it's sunshine or rain day, just as long as we're together. Thanks for being my best friend, even if the world should end. You know you always can depend. Depending on you, you're all that keeps me in control. You are the melody, heavenly symphony. You are the turn my face up towards the sky and thank the good Lord that I found you. I know that there could never be anybody else for me, and I just want to make you see.
As always, the song of the show is brought to you by the official CDB website store. Okay, I'm wearing the Yes, I'm Old, But I Saw the Charlie Daniels Band on Stage, the bootleg shirt that we ripped off the bootleggers. I've had a bunch of fake profiles posting bootleg shirts on Facebook again, so it just never ends. But anyway, if you want to get back at them, take one of their ideas and steal it from them. So anyway, that's what we did. And don't forget about the Devil Went Down to Georgia tees, the Drinking My Baby Goodbye 35th Anniversary shirts, along with the koozies, the 50th Anniversary, Charlie Daniels Band 50th Anniversary shirt, excuse me. The shirts are very cool because on the back they have the discography from 1972 on up until now, except we didn't, the shirts were produced before the Jam album came out, so sorry about that one. That one's not on there, but and maybe we should do some Jam shirts from this the cover. We'll think about that. But anyway, Benghazi ain't going away, and it still ain't going away. Dad tweeted those words out almost every day since 2012, and we keep doing it out there despite what the trolls keep objecting to. We're still gonna keep doing it. Idle Strings bracelets are beautiful and rare because they're made from actual strings used on stage by the band. This beautiful new turquoise open cross with red beads. Just love this design. And we have men's designs too, because I've got one right here, turquoise cross. And we have CDs and DVDs and books. And you know, we're gonna have even more things. We're still going through the all the archives that we have, and so there will be more stuff coming eventually, I promise. And by listening to the podcast, we are sharing discount codes. This next podcast code is podcast9, podcast with the number 9, podcast9 altogether. That will save you 35% on all orders at store.charliedaniels.com. So be sure, check it out. Christmas will be around here before too long, and you know, for the CDB fan on your list, there's a lot of cool stuff to choose from. All right, we had a lot to talk about with Henry Paul last time. So here's more of the man who is his own opening act.
Going back to the very beginning, when I would go to radio stations, if I was on the road with a CDB and I'd go and represent the Outlaws at radio with Charlie, you know, I would sit in the room and we would both have microphones and I'd kind of watch and listen. And your dad would do things like, he would go around to the different personnel at the station and he would go in and say hello and shake everybody's hand, and he would create this atmosphere of close camaraderie. And Charlie was a great ambassador for his own musical cause. And he, you know, he taught me a lot about representing my band at radio. And he, you know, he was the sort of the senior member of that entire genre. And
yeah.
And we all kind of looked up to him and respected him in that role.
Yeah.
And he never shrank from his role as the senior sort of representative of that genre. He was always, I remember at Ronnie Van Zant's funeral in Jacksonville, Charlie got up and sang Peace in the Valley. Well, I was tore up. We were all tore up. I think Don Barnes, I think it was Don Barnes, was playing guitar and somebody was playing dobro. Your dad was singing. And it was a role that only he could have filled. Nobody in that room could have represented the emotional connection and sadness of that entire musical community other than your father, because your dad was always a very respected and appealing personality. Ronnie, me, Toy, Tommy, Dickie, everybody, Greg, everybody respected and loved your father for the right reasons. Yeah. We knew how hard he struggled. Club bands back in Carolina, like I said, the Corbett Daniels thing, all the Uneasy Rider, just the that long, bumpy uphill climb to get where he got was so respected by the other members of that community.
Yeah, he worked. He definitely worked hard to get where he was. You mentioned Ronnie, and I looked for years trying to find a picture of Dad and Ronnie together, and I missed the 80th birthday. I was wanting to give it to him for his 80th birthday. Didn't happen. Somebody posted pictures on Facebook of Dad and Ronnie. It was that last night of the torture tour in Jacksonville, which is kind of infamous because Ronnie couldn't sing and there was almost a riot down there. But there's a picture of Dad talking with Gary, with Leonard Skinner, the coach, in the background, and then Ronnie in the foreground. He's got the key. He's got the key to the city around his neck and wearing a shirt that says "Who the F are the Rolling Stones?" Right. And then there's another picture of him that you can see he's kind of looking up at Dad because Dad was, I guess, considerably taller than he was. But Gary's big old head is blocking most of it. But I was able to finally get those framed and give them to him, like for his 81st birthday and Christmas that year. But I wanted to ask you a little bit about Ronnie, because one of the highlights, well, first of all, Volunteer Jam 5, which Henry Paul Band was at, you guys did Grey Ghost, which is just an amazingly powerful song. Free Bird Falling from the Sky brings a bitter end to another Southern man. That's some heavy duty stuff. But that jam was so Ronnie anyway, because not only did the surviving members of Leonard Skinner perform, Dad did a song called Reflections the first time, and the final verse is about Ronnie, and he's just struggling to get through that last verse of that song. And then for the band to do the, Leon was still, his arm was still in the cast, so he couldn't play bass. Charlie Hayward was playing bass. Dad was playing guitar, and they did a very bizarre version of Call Me the Breeze with Taz singing, but then they did the instrumental of Freebird and shown the spotlight down on the empty microphone, which was just one of the just gave you chills. But Grey Ghost, just still one of my favorite songs from all of your multiple acts that you've been with over the years.
I had a hard time introducing that song. And if you look at the video, I don't break down, but at the very end, I think the monologue went something like, "We're going to do a song that I wrote for a friend of mine who couldn't be here tonight."
Yeah.
And his name's Ronnie Van Zant, and this is a song for him called Grey Ghost. And I ducked my head down as I'm doing that because I'm about to break down. It was, even just having this conversation about it, just turns that emotional crank in me. I mean, there will never be a, hang on. Hey, honey. Yeah, I can't talk right now. I'm doing a podcast with Charlie Daniels. I'll call you back. Sorry about that.
That's okay. We got to keep the ladies when they got to let them know that you're there.
But it was a very emotional night that way. And I know the Skinner guys were there, and they were all broken and beaten and bandaged and just hideous looking. All of them. Metal coming out of their skin and clamps. Yeah. Jesus, it was just, they were all just broken and shattered. You know, it was that about as close to home, and we were pretty still fairly, you know, younger middle-aged guys, and we had never had to deal with that. It's different now when we're older and, you know, your dad lived to be 80 something, and okay, that was, it's a sad thing, but it's, I mean, that's how life is, but it wasn't supposed to be like that for them.
Right.
And it was very, very sad, and, but poignant and uplifting at the same time, you know? So it was emotional. Yeah.
I just recently watched Artemis's movie. Have you seen that yet? The Street Survivors?
I haven't seen that.
Yeah. It's, you know, you know, it was very low budget, but, you know, it's, since it's all told from his perspective, you know, I don't know how much is, you know, factual and how much is Hollywood, but there was a lot of things about it that I wasn't sure about. But as I'm watching the movie, the one thing that kept crossing my mind was, I wonder if Dad would have wanted to see this.
Right.
Because, you know, it shows them, you know, Ronnie kind of walking down the aisle, kind of saying, you know, his goodbyes to people and grabs a bottle of Jack and sits down and just kind of, you know, waits, you know, for things. So it's kind of, it's unsettling. It is. And so it might be the kind of thing you may not want to see it. So I know it is kind of since you knew him, I don't think I ever met Ronnie. If I did, I was so young, I don't remember it.
Sure.
So, but,
Buddy Holly, those kind of people, when in death, they become bigger than life.
Yeah.
And Ronnie was one of those people. Now, he was a very charismatic and very polarizing personality as a grown, you know, as a living musical celebrity. Yeah. He always had some, like, reason behind what he thought, said, or did. There was always something motivating him to do everything he did. He wasn't whimsical and sort of casual in his choices. He was very thought through. He and I had conversations about Jimmy Rogers and Merle Haggard. He loved country music. Not necessarily what country music became, but what it was, what I loved about it in. And then the country rock thing from California, whether it was Poco or the Buffalo Springfield or the folk rock thing with the Birds or the country rock band, the Outlaws, or any of those musical personalities, even Charlie Daniels, you know, a country rock musical personality. Right. We all had this affection for it. And Ronnie was deeply invested in Merle Haggard. And it went beyond Merle, but Merle was our touchstone artist that we all revered, and Willie Nelson and Waylon and Texas, that whole movement. It was very exciting for us. And I think if Ronnie had lived, he probably would have, I would very much expected him to make a record in the country music genre. And it wouldn't have been, you know, it wouldn't have been twangy or anything. It would have been more bluesy. But Call Me the Breeze. I mean, Ronnie was a very expressive sort of singer.
Yeah. That is kind of, you know, you go all the what ifs. I mean, aside from just losing a friend, the wondering what music he would have created if, because they were still at the top of their game. I mean, they were, you know, they were as hot as, you know, a firecracker, you know, when the crash happened. So no telling what would have continued to have, you know, come out of that creative genius.
So, yeah, it was sad for Steve Gaines to have finally, I know Steve shopped his solo Steve Gaines music in Macon. I heard a lot of it. It was really exceptional. But for whatever reason, he didn't connect with anyone. It was, but for him to get that job and then to have it taken away from him like that with his young wife, you know, Teresa, and his young daughter, Karina, and it was just wholly sad. And they just bought a nice, very modest home down in Orange Park, and his life was finally going somewhere and gone. So,
and well, we've talked about sad stuff enough. You mentioned Tommy Crane earlier. Yeah. He wasn't available, but you got another Crane that wasn't too shabby either. When the Henry Paul band, Billy Bill. So, how was it playing with Billy?
It was historically important. First of all, yeah. Billy was a much more wild and carefree kind of character back then.
Right.
Part of my job was keeping an eye on Billy, you know, making sure that things went pretty much the way they were supposed to go with us and him. He was the brightest light in the band as a musical personality. I wrote songs and created the musical sort of character, and he went out and put his incredibly gifted ability as a guitar player and really in his own way, you know, helped make that band what it was. He was a very accomplished and ridiculously talented musical personality, and he was the lightning in the band. Jim Fish, a guy I met when he was either in high school or just out of high school, living in Albany, New York. A mutual friend of mine in Greenwich Village told me about Jim. And they were, this friend of mine in the village was from Albany. And Jim got on a bus and would come down to Greenwich Village and live with me in my apartment. And we'd sit up and play guitar all day, and we'd write songs, and we put together a band called Sienna. The band got invited back to Florida to perform. Jim came down with me. The band's historical sort of story didn't play out exactly how we had hoped. He wound up moving back to New York. I wound up the band Sienna. Monty was in the band Sienna, then Frank was in the band Sienna, then Huey was in the band Sienna, and then we changed the name to the Outlaws, then Billy joined the Outlaws, then we got a deal, and the rest was history. But I kept Jim in the back of my mind, and when I had a chance to form the Henry Paul band, I called Jim to see if he wanted to take another shot at coming down and doing that. And he was very, I think, appreciative of the opportunity. Jim had this Clarence White string bender musical personality that was a great color on that record. His singing voice with mine was at the center, along with Barry Rapp, was at the center of the band's vocal personality. Billy was the fire, you know, the fire plug, the heavy hitter guitar player that could sell the band's musical issues on stage. Wally was an incredibly gifted bassist and solid kind of co-leader of the band with me. And Bill Hoffman was a great drummer and a great guy. And so the Henry Paul band was, you know, a really exceptional band. Jim left the band. Touring was not easy for Jim, being on the road, the whole his substance issues. He wasn't doing anything that the rest of us were doing. I think he internalized it a little bit differently. And David Feaster joined the band, and David Feaster and Billy Crane together were like ridiculous. We did this national tour with the Rosington Collins band. And unfortunately, the Henry Paul band never really, we were kind of at the tail end of that musical phenomenon. And we had significant success, especially with Grey Ghost. But we disbanded in 1983. And went on to go different ways, you know. And then Billy and I reconvened in Nashville. But, you know, the funny thing about the Henry Paul Band is it was a Nashville-based band.
Yeah.
Your dad and Joe were at the center of our day-to-day management thing. Robert Stewart was involved. Yeah. Steve Grill had left Sound 70 by then. We were being booked by Paragon still, and Paragon turned into another agency and moved to Atlanta. Alex Hodges was still our responsible agent. It was a wonderful time and a great learning experience and growing experience for me, you know, to go into a band with my name on it after leaving the Outlaws.
You probably know this, but at the last Volunteer Jam, which ended up being a tribute to Dad,
yes,
Billy became, I guess, the last official, you know, new member of the CDB, and they, and he filled in, and some of the other, Chris Warmer, he had commitments to his job, and just, there was other things, but anyway, so Billy stepped in, and after they had done the Bowweevils project together, it was kind of a nice little kind of, you know, way to kind of send it off that he got to finally, you know, share the stage, even though it was as a tribute, but still he got to be a member of the CDB after all these years.
And so, his brother.
Yeah, exactly.
Tommy was an enormous part of the Charlie Daniels Band, just
very much so.
I mean, he was shoulder to shoulder with your dad. Of course, Taz was a great musical personality, but Tommy had a very highly visible and very important musical role in that band. So
Dad always said that he made him better. He made him want to play better because Tommy was so good that it was almost, you wanted to try to match Tommy because he was so up here. Not that Dad was, you know, another slouch himself, but they brought out the best in each other, I guess would be a good way to put it.
They had a great body of work together. Tommy and Billy were rich kids from Bellmead.
Yep.
Their dad had this enormously successful commercial construction company, and those kids grew up in a very privileged home and a very financially privileged background, and it's so funny to me because they both turned their back on it and they both went a completely different way and they both had significant success. And it's a really cool story because they sort of took the Bellmead thing and the Silver Spoon and they said, screw that. And they went out and joined a rock band and had an amazing life.
Yeah.
Amazing life.
Yeah. Well, Henry, I know you got to get ready for a show, but I appreciate you taking time. This is great. I'm sure we could do this for probably another couple hours, but maybe we'll have you back on sometime.
Absolutely. And listen, good luck to you and your mom and everything that y'all are doing to perpetuate your father's memory, and you can just take my respect and affection for him with you.
Thank you very much. All right. Take care, Henry.
Really enjoyed talking with Henry. Thanks to him for being our guest, and be sure to check out the Outlaws and Black Hawk coming to your area sometime soon. Okay, last two episodes I read my Soapbox Junior about the ill-fated Honky Tonk Avenue album and my mission to locate the masters and to try to get the album released in as close to its original form as possible, as it should have been released back in 1984. And then last episode I did an addendum to the original Soapbox. This week I wanted to go back to something that I wrote last year in 2021 to promote the Volunteer Jam, A Musical Salute to Charlie Daniels show that happened, and I did a breakdown of all the Volunteer Jams from the first one all the way up to the last one, The Musical Salute to Charlie Daniels. And so since we're promoting the Jam, first Jam album, I thought we would talk about the first Jam. Volunteer Jam, The Legend Begins, Soapbox Junior. In 1974, the CDB was working on an album which would be called Fire on the Mountain, which would be the fourth album released by Kama Sutra Records, an imprint of Buddha Records. The recording was done at the legendary Capricorn Studios in Macon, Georgia, where many Southern rock bands recorded. including the Marshall Tucker Band, Allman Brothers, and many more. Dad worked hard on this album. Dad worked hard on the album and got together songs he felt were top-notch, including a few that he had previously recorded but felt they needed another take. According to Dad, on previous albums, he had tried to sound like other people, most likely because he'd spent about 10 years playing cover tunes in clubs and was always trying to sound like somebody else, sound like the original artists. So that carried over into the studio. It took him a few albums to try something he hadn't before, to open up his mouth in front of the microphone, and whatever came out, it would be all him, and no affectation and no imitation of someone else. 100% authentic Charlie Daniels. They recorded the studio portion of the album, but Dad wanted to include two live recordings, a song from the Honey in the Rock album, which was later re-released as Uneasy Rider on Epic Records, called No Place to Go, and a cover of the old Irvin T. Rouse, Chubby Wise, Fiddle Standard, Orange Blossom Special. They were looking for a place to record, and because the CDB success had been limited at that time, Uneasy Rider was a top 10 hit on radio, but it didn't translate into record sales. Finding a venue where they could draw a crowd was critical. A live recording with hardly any crowd might as well have been done in a studio. So they looked to their home base in Nashville, figuring they could draw, you know, the most people there. And they settled on War Memorial Auditorium. It's not a big place. It holds about 2,000, but it meant that it would most likely sell out and there would be a full house, and the show was indeed a sellout. They decided to call this one-and-done live recording session the Volunteer Jam because it was taking place in the Volunteer State of Tennessee. Dad also invited a few friends to join in and jam, which is basically unrehearsed music created on the spot, usually a blues riff, or sometimes it may be a song that everybody knows, and they just kind of wing it with following the lead of someone who is loosely directing the musicians and letting them know when it's their time to take solos. For the Derek and the Dominoes album, Layla, and other assorted love songs, the jam sessions were legendary, with Eric Clapton, Dwayne Allman, Bobby Whitlock, Jim Gordon, and Carl Radel recording hours and hours of jamming. Those were finally pared down into a full CD of the Layla box set released in the early 1990s. So, Toy Caldwell, Jerry Eubanks, and Paul Riddle from the Marshall Tucker Band, and Dickie Betts, who also performed the Dobro solo on the Longhaired Country Boy studio track, all came down for the festivities. And, of course, Dickie being with the Allman Brothers. A hot band from Nashville called Buckeye opened the show and would have an impact on the CDB for many years to come. Two very talented brothers led Buckeye, Tommy and Billy Crane, and they had a roadie named Roger Campbell. In 1975, three of the band's members left at once, and that's when Don Murray, Charlie Hayward, Tommy Crane all joined the band. And a couple of years later, after that, Roger Campbell became roadie for the CDB, a position he would hold until July 6, 2020. The show became a success. Unfortunately, I can't give you a first-person account because I wasn't there. In my defense, I was 9 years old. I had seen Dad perform many times, and I went on the road with him, and I figured it would be a really late night, and to be honest, I didn't know how historical the night would be. Whoops. But I never missed another one, and there would be many more. The show was a success, and they did many of them, and they were always a blast. When the original vinyl albums were pressed, the record included a 45 RPM disc, but oddly had an LP-sized hole instead of the bigger hole in the middle, of the instrumental jam highlights. Sadly, when Epic Records purchased the CBS catalog from Kama Sutra, the Volunteer Jam disc was not included in any of the pressings from Epic. So there you have the condensed story of the very first Volunteer Jam and the two songs which helped make Fire on the Mountain a landmark album for the CDB. I wish I had known what the jam would have been for Dad and the band over the years. It was their semi-annual homecoming concert from 1974 to 1996, with a few breaks here and there. I wish I had gone to the show and gotten to see and hear the performances, But one day, about 5 or 6 years ago, I was looking through our tape vault, and I came across something which made my eyes almost pop out of my head. It was a DAT, a digital audio tape, of the 1974 Volunteer Jam. And, like, mind blown. I got our engineer to transfer it, and for the first time in my life, aside from Orange Blossom Special and No Place to Go, I heard the CDB's set for the very first Volunteer Jam. And even the jamming that followed along with some interesting covers. Maybe we can do something with it someday. We'd sure love to share it with you. As Dad proudly proclaimed at the first and almost every Volunteer Jam, ain't it good to be alive and be in Tennessee? As I mentioned last time, please share this hashtag on social media. For those not watching, and you should be watching, I'm right here. You can see me. That's Sony Release Honky Tonk Ave with the abbreviation for Avenue of AVE, Sony Release Honky Tonk Ave. Let's see if we can make this happen. That's all we have time for all things CDB, the podcast, new releases, merchandise, and more. Go to charliedaniels.com and be sure to subscribe so you know when the next episode drops and you can see me or hear me, but see me. Check me out. It's cool. It's fun to get to actually watch this stuff. But anyway, this is Charlie Daniels Jr. Let's all make the day count. And don't forget, Benghazi, it ain't going away. Neither is inflation or the Ukraine stuff that's going on or Afghanistan leaving so many people behind over a year. It's all... Dad, we miss your voice, and I'm going to try and delve into some of this, but I've had a lot on my plate here lately, but I'm going to try and get something together in the vein of Dad's soapboxes, from the political and current events standpoint, so stay tuned for that.